Our museum is just 10 minutes away from the dig site, which is what has made us one of the best dinosaur museums in the world, because we don't have to transport people hundreds and thousands of miles to where the bones are. This whole thing got started in 1993. The goal was a team of people are going to search the hills of Thermopolis for one dinosaur. So they'd get in there, dig it up quickly, and then move on. But as soon as they started getting up here and looking at all the hillsides, they learned there was a lot more than just one dinosaur buried here. So they decided, instead of transporting these bones hundreds, if not thousands of miles across the globe to other museums, why not build a museum right here so our bones just have to survive a 10-minute drive down the road? So the museum itself was opened in 1995 as a permanent home for the fossils that were found outside the hills of Thermopolis. And then it just became one of the best dinosaur museums in the world in the years after that.
Paleontology is part of Wyoming's legacy. Paleontologists came to our state back in the 1870s to excavate dinosaurs because they're not found usually on the East Coast, so they had to come here. Most museums that visit our state take the fossils and the dinosaurs out. Our museum is special because we still have our dinosaurs here and on display for the public that we're finding here.
So what did these sauropods eat? Plants, right.
The Wyoming Dinosaur Center facilitates several educational programs for the public, including one called Dig for a Day, where visitors can go out into the dig sites with the paleontologists on staff and look for dinosaur bones.
From the very beginning, our goal was to bring everyday people out to our property, 7,500 acres of prime real estate for dinosaurs and other prehistoric creatures. And we wanted people to get the firsthand experience of what it's actually like to be a paleontologist. So every day during the summer, we take people out to the sites to dig dinosaurs along with us. You're working right alongside our staff and lots of paleontologists, and nothing's planted. You're working in a real active dinosaur site, and we don't know where the bones are and where they're going to turn up. All we know is that we're digging in the right place at the right time, and most of the bones that are found here are not found by our staff. They're found by everyday people who are doing this for the very first time. So we're training people how to do our job every day.
Everything we do is to try and increase scientific knowledge for people. We want families to come out here and see what real paleontology is like. Whenever we come out here, it's always one family per guide or per pair of guides. We want each family to have an individualized experience.
So when someone finds a bone, we keep it here at the museum, but they get logged in our records as the official bone finder. Their name's attached with that bone for the rest of history. We bring it down to the museum, we'll work on it in our prep lab, get it cleaned up, and that's when the real research begins to figure out not just the bone that you found, but what's the story behind that bone. And most of our best discoveries have been made in the lab, which is another portion of the process that we invite people to participate in through our Dig for a Day and Paleo Prep programs.
We fund our operations through the Dig for a Days, through people coming to the museum to see the dinosaur bones, doing dig site tours. That's what keeps gas in our cars. That's what keeps us coming up here every single day to work at the dig sites.
Wyoming Dinosaur Center's most massive occupant is Jimbo, a supersaurus discovered near Douglas, Wyoming. But while working at the Jimbo dig site, paleontologists exposed a much smaller, but no less significant discovery.
So the way I was told, Bill was supervising digs in the site one day and he saw a little cluster of bones sitting at the surface and he literally threw himself on top of it to make sure no one stepped on it. And then with the most precise tools that he had at that moment, he starts chipping away at the rock to see this little specimen.
In 2001, we had student groups working at the site in Douglas, Wyoming, and the Lori specimen was found about 10 centimeters above the Jimbo display. So the large sauropod that's on display in the museum, the bones were coming out of that. This little theropod was found right above that site.
And it is the smallest dinosaur found in the state of Wyoming. It's a new species, new genus and species. That itself is kind of important for our state because it's a new species of dinosaur. People are going to be talking about it.
You rarely get small things within an environment. You'll get something big like a dinosaur, you might get crocodiles, you might get turtles, but to find a small theropod dinosaur like this along with it, that's telling you the other parts of the environment.
A paper published in July of 2019 first introduced Lori to the world. Lori, along with another of the museum's most important specimens, one of the world's best preserved Archaeopteryx, are important links to begin explaining the relationship between dinosaurs and birds.
We consider birds as living dinosaurs, but we don't fully understand a lot of how that happened. Like, when did flight appear? When did arms stop becoming used for grabbing and be used for powered flight? Those are questions we haven't answered. Lori is going to fill in a lot of those gaps. Based on the information we've collected in our paper, Lori is the earliest member of the raptor family. So we all know Velociraptor. This is Velociraptor's grandmother, in a sense. Now we have a much earlier raptor from North America from the late Jurassic period. That's pushing the origins of the dromaeosaurs, the Velociraptor family, back several million years onto an entirely different continent.
It's exciting because you're getting a fuller picture of that environment. You know, here's a small predator. This wasn't taking down sauropods. This was going after bugs. This was going after maybe small mammals or frogs or lizards along that lakeshore. We hope to make the Lori specimen a hallmark specimen of the Dinosaur Museum. So for any future building projects, display projects, something like that, make it part of it. I mean, we have the largest dinosaur in the state of Wyoming and the smallest dinosaur in the state of Wyoming. So that's kind of cool. That's good bookends.
Each day, the Wyoming Dinosaur Center provides a unique opportunity for visitors to discover the next important piece of the Paleolithic record. That, coupled with their mission to keep Wyoming discoveries in Wyoming, makes it a true gem that the state can be proud of.
We are the ones who say, we don't care how much experience you have, we don't care what your age is, come out here and we'll show you what it is to dig up dinosaurs.
There's enough dig sites and specimens to work on here for the next 100 years easily. So we find new sites almost every year, so there's plenty of work to be done.
As I like to say it, the world knows dinosaurs because of Wyoming, and now it's time that Wyoming gets credit for it.
We dig up bones. It's hard work. It takes a while, but it's also really fun and very satisfying when you do find something.
You never know what the next shovel full of stuff's going to bring out. It might be the same, something you've seen 1,000 times over. It might be something completely different. It's the chase, it's the discovery, it's the explanation, and it's fun. It's fun.